This is Susmit Kumar. I'm a PhD from Penn State. My website is www.susmitkumar.net. This talk's title is Arab Spring and Modernization of Islam. On September 11, 2001, on the same day when Islamic terrorists hijacked U.S. airlines and killed so many Americans, the same day Condi Rice, U.S. National Security Advisor, was to outline a Bush administration policy to address the threats and problems of today and the day after, not the world of yesterday. According to former U.S. officials who saw the text of his speech. The source is Washington Post news article. So her focus was largely on missile defense, not terrorism, from Islamic radicals, and also to promote missile system as the cornerstone of the new national security strategy. There was no mention of Al-Qaeda, Osama bin Laden, or Islamic extremist group. It mentioned terrorism, but did so as one of the dangers from rogue nations such as Iraq that might use weapons of terror. But the speech was postponed in the chaos of the day. On the other hand, in 1995, I wrote an article in Global Times, which was published from Denmark. The abstract on the top was, the U.S. has sowed the seeds of the next Cold War by employing the low-cost war strategy in Afghanistan. Although a rise in Islamic fundamentalist movements worldwide was inevitable, U.S. involvement in Afghanistan only hastened the process. Then on another page, I wrote that, although fundamentalist Islamic states and powerful Islamic clerics in those states will be the loser of a cold or third world war, Islam as a religion will emerge victorious and shed its 7th century image, becoming a new 21st century religion more tolerant to women and non-Muslims. Then again on another page, I wrote that after the fall of oil-rich countries like Saudi Arabia to radical Islamic militants, Islamic clerics will try to establish an Islamic empire like the old Ottoman Empire. Then in the conclusion, I wrote that in the same way, two world wars changed the socio-economic and political environment of Europe, this war will change the Middle East and North Africa, which resembles late 19th and early 20th century Europe. One thing which is important here, that I wrote this in an article in December 1995. Then in 2008, I published a book on the base of the 1995 article. On the front, this title is The Modernization of Islam and the Creation of a Multipolar World Order. On the front cover page, I wrote this sentence, final outcome of global Islamic militancy, the emergence of new Kemal Ataturks and liberating transition to Turkey's model of secular democracy. It was a well-researched book, number of references were 642. There was a chapter in it, The Collapse of American Economy. And in 2012, I extended that chapter to a book, Casino Capitalism. So what we are witnessing right now is a major step towards the unification of human civilization. The Arab Spring is a major step towards the unification of human civilization and not the class of civilization theory of Samuel Huntington. Let us see the effect of two world wars. Hitler was trying to create a colonial power which, according to him, will last for thousands of years. Instead, he destroyed the colonialism. After the Second World War, Britain, France, the then colonial power, didn't have money. Their economy was destroyed, so that's why they left their all colonies. For example, Jordan in 46, Palestine in 1947, India again 1947, Burma in 48, Egypt in 52, Malaysia in 57. France also left its entire colony, which was called Indochina, Laos in 48, Cambodia in 1953, Vietnam in 1954. So, I am originally from India, and people all over the world say that it was Mahatma Gandhi which was behind the independence of India in 1947. But if you take out Mahatma Gandhi out of picture, India still would have obtained the independence in 47, like the all other countries. On the other hand, if you take out evil Hitler and Second World War, India might have obtained the independence after 40, 60 years. And Gandhi would not have been there, alive. He would have been dead. So, as history is written by victors, that's why we claim that Mahatma Gandhi was behind the independence of India. Also, the effect of two world wars were that European countries were fighting among themselves for thousands of years, and suddenly they are moving towards unification. Nobody would have predicted it in early 1900s. Nearly all kingdoms are gone because of two world wars. In these kind of events, although millions lost lives, these events worked as a catalyst for the evolution of human civilization. They bring changes in a few decades which otherwise would have taken several centuries. So I give the example of birth of a beautiful child. So in order to give birth to a beautiful child, a woman has to go through labor pain. The same last century, early last century, Europe went through it, and now it is the Middle East and North African countries which are going through it. So present situation in MENA countries, they are unstable, similar to early 1900 Europe. Pakistan, Afghanistan, Yemen, Mali, Sudan, Somalia, Libya, Syria, Egypt, Iraq, Tunisia are on the verge of falling to the hands of Islamic fundamentalists. Pakistan created the Taliban in 1990s for proxy rule in Afghanistan. But the situation is Taliban may take over in entire Pakistan. It is just a question of time that the moment US withdraw troops from Afghanistan, Afghanistan will fall to the Taliban and next will be Pakistan. So Islamic fundamentalist groups like ISIS was created by Sunni countries like Saudi Arabia, Qatar and Turkey to get rid of Shia rulers in Iraq and Syria. Later on, now these same countries which created ISIS, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, etc., they are threatened by it. Here is this JPEG or the news report published in a British newspaper that Saudi Arabia is placing 3,000 soldiers on its border in the wake of ISIS threat. So, what will be the situation? So, war front will be Europe, India, Israel, Russia, China, and US. If the Iran manufactures or comes up with the nuclear bomb, then next will be Saudis and the Egypt and the Islamic fundamentalists when they took over. And countries like Pakistan, Saudis, and Egypt, they will take over the nuclear bomb. They will have. So then we will see nuclear attacks on India, Israel, Europe, China, and Russia. So in the end, Islamic fundamentalists will try to impose the 7th century Arabian culture, that is the Sharia rule, on a 25th century population, but they will not be successful. So in the end, we will see rise of new Kemal Ataturk in MENA countries and liberating transition to the Turkey's model of secular democracy. And this process will take decades. It is not just 1 year, 2 years. Just like the two world wars took several decades to bring changes in Europe, this will also take time. So Islam, what is Islam? It was founded in 7th century by Prophet Muhammad, who was a great person who united entire Arabian Peninsula, which was divided into several clans. But Sharia is based on hadiths or sayings of Prophet Muhammad. If you take out the divinity part of Sharia, then divinity part of Quran or Sharia, they are social cultures of the 7th century Arabia only. As there was no prison at that time, so that's why there is eye for an eye in Sharia and Quran. Because if somebody is held guilty, what you will do with them? So in pre-Islam Arabia, women didn't have any rights. Muhammad provided some rights to women, which are seen too restrictive now. Founder of all religions, were great person of the times. So it is wrong to criticize Muhammad. We should blame those who are following the 7th century culture today, or the practice today. Now the question is, why the modernization of Islam is needed? Islam is the only religion being enforced by several countries. Non-Muslims have limited rights in those several of these countries. For example, in Malaysia, M. Murthy, who was a Hindu, was a national hero because he was the first Malaysian to climb Mount Everest. And he was in army. Before his death, he was in coma for a couple of weeks in a hospital. After his death, his superiors in army claimed that just before his death, he changed it to Islam. So despite best effort of his family members, wife and kids, he was given Muslim burial. Although his wife and his family went up to the highest judiciary court, but they said no, because the Sharia court decided that he was a Muslim. So in civil cases, non-Muslim get only fraction of what Muslims get. In Saudi Arabia, non-Muslim literature or even practice at home any religion other than Islam aren't allowed. Until 1800s, Jews and Zoroastrians paid jizya, which is the non-Muslim tax. Then during Ottomans, Jews were not allowed to ride horses and they had to wear clothes and shoes of a particular color. Conversion to Islam is allowed, but not the reverse. Quran gives death penalty in the second case. Let us say about the South Asia. Near the independence, that is 1947, in 1951, India had 9.9% Muslims population, and Pakistan and Bangladesh both had in 20s, 20%, 24%. But now the number of Muslims in India, the percentage wise, has increased by 50%, that is 14.6, where in Pakistan and Bangladesh it has gone down drastically. The reason is that Pakistan and Bangladesh, there are forced conversion. And also they kidnap young Hindu girls, 7 to 8 years old, and marrying them to Muslims. And it is worth noting that Pakistan, India and Bangladesh had the top second, third and fourth population in the world. So Prophet Muhammad lived in an era when religious discrimination was a norm. So here we will see that why Sharia had these kind of rules against non-Muslim. Roman emperors like Diocletian before Roman emperors became the Christian, they used to persecute Christians. Byzantine rulers, the Eastern Roman Empire, until 1461, periodically killed Jews and burned the, down the synagogues. Until Middle Ages, that is 1300 AD, nearly all Christian rulers in Europe discriminated against non-Christian. Hindu also had their own Sharia, which was called Manusmriti. Non-Hindus were considered even below the lowest caste, and they didn't have any rights. So, for example, in Spain, Christian rulers persecuted Jews under the canons of Council of Toledo. They forced non-Christian to convert to Christianity or else give 100 stocks of rot and exile. Confiscation of properties. Families were broken up. They used to forcibly take away the children of Jews to bring up in Christian faith. In 1227, Pope Gregory IX decreed that Muslims and Jews must wear distinctive clothes, not to appear on the street during Christian festivals, and they were forbidden to hold public office. During the 19th century, there were anti-Jewish pogroms in Russia. Here also in the US, televangelists clearly say that only Christians would go to heaven and non-Christian will go to hell. US is the number one country in modernization, but here US is the most advanced country in the world, but here we have a creation museum in Kentucky according to which Earth is only 6,000 years old and human and dinosaurs live together. They coexisted. So if the followers of TV evangelists would become in majority, then we will see the persecution of non-Christians here. Non-Christians would have to either convert to Christianity or leave the country. This photo is very famous. It was published in the front page of not only US but all over the world newspapers. It was taken in the White House Situation Room. All these US top officials and the like President Obama, Vice President Hillary Clinton and all others were watching the live killing of Osama bin Laden. Here we see two women, Hillary Clinton and one another woman in the back. The same photo was published next day in a Jewish newspaper published from New York, Brooklyn, and they deleted the two women because according to them, women picture should not be shown in the public and should not be in the public. So this type of Sharia type rule was there in each and every religion, but they got over it. Here we see there is a direct relationship of education and religion. In US, number of pupils with bachelor's or higher degree for persons above 25 years and above is 27.9%. Out of 50 states, the top 10, Oklahoma, Indiana, Tennessee, Alabama, Nevada, Louisiana, Kentucky, Mississippi, Arkansas, and West Virginia, they are the bottom one, and they are Bible Belt. Christian conservatives are in majority. On the other hand, in the MENA countries, Middle East and North African countries, it is just 15%, even below the West Virginia. But on the other hand, top 10 are blue states, and they have higher education level, highest education level. So there is a direct relationship between the education and religion. Here, this is a photo of in the sun and its stars. In 1970s, NASA sent four spacecraft, Voyager 1, Voyager 2, Pioneer 10 and Pioneer 11. They are in almost 45 years, they are on the verge of crossing the solar boundary. And a couple of these four has already crossed, and they are in interstellar region. These are the first ever spacecrafts which would enter the interstellar space, that is the region between the stars. Voyager 1 and 2 would reach their nearest stars in 40,000 years. All four are going into four different directions. Pioneer 10 and 11 could reach their nearest stars in 2 million years. So once you read all these, then you stop believing that God created the universe in 6 days. Religious freedom in US and Europe is there not because forefathers of non-Christians fought for it, but because of the secularized majority who gradually realized that because of the socio-political enlightenment that it is wrong to limit religious freedom. In India also, non-Hindus are free to observe the religion for the same reason. But this same secularized majority is missing in nearly all Muslim majority countries. In India, they have same criminal code for everyone, but civil code is religion based. Once a Muslim doctor wrote to me through my website, where I had written that India should have the same civil code for all the religion. He wrote to me that I do not know anything about Islam or Sharia, etc. I should not write it. Then I replied to him, why you are asking only the civil code? Why should not the Indian government give you the criminal code of Sharia? That if a Hindu, Christian or Jews is found guilty, he will go to jail. But if a Muslim is found guilty, his hands will be chopped off or eyes will be put. He didn't reply to me. So outside forces cannot bring long lasting changes, and hence the change should come from within. MENA countries will be observing struggle between new and old guards. Old guards will try to go back to Islamic Empire era. That is, they will try to turn back the clock, but they will be successful. At the end of the crisis, Islam will cease to be a factor in politics, and it will become like Christianity, Hinduism or Buddhism. Until first millennium, Buddhism was also enforced by several rulers in India. But the cost of modernization may be more than World War II, and it will take several decades. Just like it took several decades for Europe in the first half of last century to have change. Let us see the history of modern Turkey. Turkey was the base of Ottoman Empire, which was founded in 1299 and it ended in 1923. During its prime years, it was far ahead of European countries. It had paved and lighted roads, universities, libraries, where at that time Europe was in dark ages. Father of algebra, that is, algebra is the symbolic solution of linear and quadratic equation. It was given by a madrasa teacher in Central Asia. The word algorithm is named after him. He also introduced to the West the concept of decimal and zero, given by Indian mathematicians. Division is very difficult using Roman numerals. One of the main region or important region of the Industrial Revolution in Europe was this, the decimal and zero. But after the collapse of Ottoman Empire, at the hands of Europe, which was growing up leaps by bound due to this industrial revolution and Renaissance. Kemal Ataturk, who was a military general in the Ottoman Empire, saw no other solution, no solution other than the modernize his Turkey. In just 2-3 years, he banned Sharia court, introduced European law, jurisprudence, introduced a brand new alphabet. He created these alphabets based on Roman script in place of old based on Arabic script. He banned Islamic dresses, including the veil and headscarf. Women were given voting rights, and also they could own properties, when women in several Western countries didn't have it. France gave voting right to women only after World War II. He also ended the Caliphate in 1924. Caliphate was started in 632 AD on the day Prophet Muhammad died. First Caliph was Prophet Muhammad's father-in-law Abu Bakr, and the last Caliph was the head of the Ottoman Empire. So, although Muslim constitute 99% of population, Turkey is a secular and democratic country since 1920. So now, what we are witnessing, the Arab Spring or the Islamic terrorism fundamentalists, is a major step towards the unification of human civilization. It is not the clash of civilization. What was the effect of technological growth during World War II and Cold War? It drastically reduced travel and transportation time among various continents from months to hours. Also, air and space travel came up. Then finally, internet. Information now travels in a fraction of seconds through the globe. And also, it brought integration of global economy. A click of mouse can send money or commodity to any part of the world. So all these have sped up the evolution of human civilization at a rate unthinkable previously. Here the picture of US in 1800s. So it was fragmented. At that time, nobody would have thought that all these states or areas will unite and become the superpower. Now here is the Europe at the beginning of year 1800. It was also fragmented. So at that time, nobody would have thought that within 150, 200 years, Europe will become united and will go towards unification like European Union. So what we are watching here is the unification of human civilization from the bottom to up, rather than imposed from the top. United Nations was imposed from the top by the victors in the after the Second World War. But this unification of human civilization is a bottom to up process. EU is the forefront right now. So we have ASEAN. EU was started as a coal and steel community, but over the years, over the decades, now it is unifying the entire Europe. Same thing is ASEAN, then SAARC, African Union, and then UNSCR, and then US and Canada. Finally, all these will merge and form a unified organization. You can call it World Union, something like World Union. In the World Union, each and every country will have their own rights, but they will have also a global umbrella. Thanks for watching.